Hi everyone, my name is Jessica Solomon and I'm the Executive Director of the Jewish Heritage Museum of Monmouth County, located in the Levi Solomon Barn in Freehold, New Jersey. Today we'll be having a virtual tour of the museum's rotating exhibit, Jews of India, the History and Practices of the B'nai Israel, Cochin, and Baghdadi Jews, led by Yohanan Perry. To learn more about the Jewish Heritage Museum of Monmouth County, please go to our website at www.jhmomc.org.
I, Yohanan Ben Yeshaya Bezalka. Anyway, when I came to the U.S., or even a little early, I became John Perry, since I was a journalist covering United Nations, when having a Hebrew name wasn't that acceptable. I donated most of the books, artifacts of my parents, grandparents to the museum, in the hope that they'll know more about my community, which is the Ben Israeli community. Our ancestors came to the shores of Maharashtra, Raigad, about over 2,000 years back. We adopted the local language, Marathi, and sometimes we are referred to as the Marathi Jews too. And we live very happily, thanks to the teachings of Hinduism, never suffered anything because we were Jews. We were treated more than equal by the Hindu community. We had good relations with the Muslims there too, until the establishment of the State of Israel in 1948, where our synagogues were given good protection by the law enforcement. And here it's a pleasure to take you on a small tour of the exhibition on Jews of India at the Jewish Museum, Monmouth County, Freehold. This is the first thing we have on the door, the mezuzah, but our mezuzah differs from the mezuzahs you see elsewhere. These are handmade mezuzahs that our ancestors would do it. And this was a sure sign that the house belonged to a B'nai Israeli, a Marathi speaking Jew. I still pray from the sindoor that was used by my father and grandfather. The first one came in 1889, the first edition. I had the second 1934. And though I know Hebrew fluently, it's a pleasure. Praying from here with the right side, I have Hebrew, Marathi on the left side. This is my treasure possession. Our women as such in India, they used to wear either a sari and a blouse. If we go back several hundred years, they would wear lugra. That would be a 9-yard sari with a different way of wearing it. This used to be a 6-yard, a different thing. And here we come, the B'nai Israel. That's the way I was referring, the way we used to dress up. This, as you see over here, the women are wearing a lugra. It's not the modern sari. It was very common for our ancestors, the male, to have beard and wear a cap, not a kippah, but a different type of a cap. Of course, there were others whose attire would be very local. And with the coming of the British Raj, naturally, we had people who would wear suits. Most of our people, they served in the army during the British Raj. Here you see this Manti, B'nai Israel teachers. This is from 1856, one of the rare photographs. One of the oldest synagogues, the Shahr al-Hakamim synagogue, also known as Gate of Mercy. It will be celebrating 225 years next year. It's in Samuel Street, Manri. And there's another synagogue over there, the Shahr al-Ratzon. We used to call this the Zuni Masjid because this is the oldest built by Diveka when he was imprisoned by the Muslims, Mughals then, and he said he was B'nai Israel. And the mother of the king realized that it's mentioned in the Quran. So, he had vowed to build a synagogue. This is the oldest religious site over here. And the inside, we have men below and we have a gallery for women. Men and women, they don't sit together. This is the Shabbat light. We have different types of Shabbat lights, but this is again made, handmade by our people. And we use oil and wick. There's the water below, then the oil floats on top, and then the wick, and we light it. And here is the ceremonial objects. Sefer Torah, it's more like, this is from the different Israel in Jacob's circle. That place too was known as, as Jacob's circle. And the Sefer Torah is based on Sephardic tradition. This is the Sefer Torah. A traditional, the Ner Tamid is there, again, oil. And, this is the Hechal, where the Sefer Torah is there. It's a traditional Bnei Israel Chanukah. And though in my house it was more modern, but again built by this. And Magid Rabot Synagogue, this is the old mezuzah. And over here is the handi. Some people would light this handi on Shabbat. Again, traditional during the high holidays, some people would even light it on Shabbat, Motzai Shabbat, especially Rosh Hashanah, Kippur, Zimat Torah. And, you have the glasses over there, again, with water, oil, wick. Sometimes, for festive occasion, they would put color in the water. So this would have a blue color as such, based on the Israeli flag. So we would have white and blue. This was like a traditional Bnei Israel, and there would be a glass light in the center. Now, apart from the Bnei Israelis, today we number about 80 to 85,000 in Israel, and there are about 10 to 15,000 in Europe, USA, Canada, Australia, New Zealand. I think we started leaving India, making Aliyah around 1950, and apart from us, we have about 25 synagogues, about 10 in Mumbai proper, and the rest in Raigarh, where our ancestors landed. We also have in New Delhi, we have in Ahmedabad, we have in Pune, we were stretched everywhere. There were other Jews of Indian origin that came to India. One of them was the Jews from Cochin. Really, they are from Cochin, and the oldest synagogue in India is in Cochin. It's not the Gate of Mercy, but it's in Cochin, and during, I think it's 200th anniversary or so, the Prime Minister of India then, Indira Gandhi, had gone there, and the government of India came up with a postal stamp for that synagogue. We owe a lot, learned to the Jews of Cochin. There's a Jew cemetery, Jew town, and till today, tourists from all over the world, they go there. They used to have two types, for some reason, Jews, the black and the white. I think if someone married outside the Jewish community, they were treated as a black Jew. But they had a very strange, that classification. I don't think it exists now. Today, the synagogues over there, they are in danger because we have hardly any Jews left over there. And there are other organizations like the American Jewish Chabad and other, they tried, or from Israel. They help them, the local Jewry. I think it's barely two families over there, whereas the Bnei Israel, we still have about 2,500 to 3,000, so we have about 10 to 12 synagogues that, operate. But the synagogues in Kerala, Cochin, it's a problem. So, here we have some pictures. And there's an excellent book. One is about the Jews of India, and it basically, gives information about the various communities in India, the Bnei Israel, the Cochin, and the Baghdadi Jews. There's another good book called Between Jerusalem and Benares by my friend Professor Hananiah Goodman. He lives in Ashdod, Israel, and as I said, there was a water scarcity in Bombay when we lived in the 40s and 50s. And it used to be, we used to have a certain time when water we would get a public tap in the building itself. And the Hindus, our neighbors, they would know that it's our festival. And they would let our women collect the water first. When we would go to the synagogues on high holidays, a crowded street, but they would move aside to let our people go on the streets. So that was this book, Between Jerusalem and Banaras, it explains very well not only the relations between the Jews and Hindus, but what is common in their religion. Some of their skull caps, you know, we used to use different ones, the Bene Israel. Basically, they came from Baghdad, Iraq, and they came more as the traders and the business people to India. And they built synagogues, they built, especially David Sassoon, synagogues, and in fact, the biggest zoo in India, the Rani Sabah, Victoria Museum as we call it, it was named after the Queen Victoria of Britain, who was then the ruler of India. That particular building was supposed to be a synagogue, but the direction wouldn't conform with the direction that a synagogue should have. So he donated it to the government, and he built another synagogue over there called the Bargain Dalit Synagogue, Mumbai. In fact, I was married to Sophie here in 69. It's in a place called Baikler. The Bene Israel would use this synagogue for wedding purposes, but I remember there as a child when we would have the function for Israeli Independence Day, Bene Israel as such, we would rent the synagogue for the wedding ceremony, but they wouldn't issue their ketubah. The ketubah, the wedding, the certificate would be from our synagogue for whatever the purpose. They have another synagogue in Pune called Lal Devar, which is very famous. They have hardly any population left now, maybe 100, 200, whatever. So in terms of the Baghdadi Jews, it's a dying community as bad as the Cochin community. But their ancestors, especially the David Sassoon family, has done lots for India. David Sassoon, basically when they came as the traders to Mumbai, and there was another community in India that gave a lot in terms of for the betterment of the community there, were the Parsis. So, basically David Sassoon and his family, they competed with the Parsis over there in building hospitals, in building, giving land. In fact, I think he was even involved in building of the Gateway of India, the big, huge structure in Bombay that's opposite the Taj Hotel. So, they, in terms of money, they did a lot for India. But that was more like investment in goodwill, if you can call it. Most of them, they did exceedingly well in India. As I said, they have moved out Europe, Canada and all, but till today they have an exhibition hall in Fort, is there, David Sassoon Library, you name it, at JJ Hospital in Mumbai, huge complex, they would have a whole section called the David Sassoon Hospital, and if any of the Bene Israel Jew or anyone is not well, we would be admitted to that hospital and would be given better treatment than the rest of the patient. So they did a lot. When it comes to art, literature, theatres, etc., Bene Israel and the Jews of India produced some of the best over there to go acting, in movies or in dramas and theatres. But they made a mark over there. But this was all, I would say, from the 30s to about 50s, 60s, and now that community has shrunk, we, as such, no outstanding Indian Jew is in Bollywood. We may not have produced that many artists in Bollywood, but there was David Abraham. So he was like, there was a movie called Good Polish that was honored even by the government of India. He was honored. So he was a Bene Israel. Most of the others were women, and they belonged to the Baghdadi Jewish community. They were the ones, now you know, it's very common over there to take a name that goes well with the viewers. So though their names were Jewish, they took Indian names like Sulochana, Rose, Nadira. Nadira was more like a Muslim name. Aarti Devi, a Hindu name, or Ramola and Pramila. So it's very common in Bollywood. You know, the actors, they don't come out and act with their own real name, but they take a pseudonym. These are my treasures, basically, from the Perry family, the Bedanka family. I'll start from here. This is my father and mother-in-law, Pinchas Samson and Dina Samson. My father-in-law was a big police officer in Mumbai. That's me and Sophie. We got married at Magadha Synagogue in 69. That's my father and mother, Isaiah, Aaron Perry and Hannah. They were in an Israeli school when they fell in love. We had a school called Israelite School, later became the Sir Ali Kadhuri School, with the funding by Sir Ali Foundation, Kadhuri Foundation, and they got married. So that's my father and mother. The Hindus would have bhajan, that is, they would sing song with the drums and all that, and you know, it would be entertaining. So what my ancestors did, they came with something so that our youth wouldn't be, or our people wouldn't be attracted to the bhajan. So the same story that we read in Bible, they did it in form of poems or songs, and it was called kirtan. So that book, you see it, is basically kirtan and the stories from the Bible, stories from Delhi, but basically this is the way, you know, those days, this was one way of educating children about Judaism. That book is one of the rarest, must be, I don't know, 18th century. I still remember my father, my mother teaching me Hebrew and Marathi songs from there. Excellent. This 1980, this was the translation, one page that we had left. It's a translation of a psalm from Telim. And, you know, my father would, I don't know, he gave importance to Marathi as such. Apart from our learning Hebrew, so though I was in the English school, he would make me read Marathi newspaper in the morning. And one of the reasons was to show that, you know, it's because of these people that we were never troubled in India for over 2,000 years. A way of saying thank you. This is, again, I remember, as calling there my name, John I. Perry. It's a Selichot in Hebrew and Marathi. I missed that book. It was printed in 1935. And our tunes differ from the way the rest of the world Jewry does it, both in terms of prayer, and we have certain thing called Eliyahu HaNavi ceremony, which we do on a Saturday night or before a wedding or Brit Mila, where we lay a thala with fruits and, you know, pohas, the Rice Krispies, and we read from the Siddur, the Eliyahu HaNavi and Vaitalekha. But it is followed by, you know, the prayers, that is Boramina Mezonot and all, where we eat from the thala. It's very rare, and you'll find it over here. The other one, Practicing Judaism, was written by me and Pinchas Solomon. Basically, it's in English, and it was meant not for the Ben Israelis who are in Israel, who are about 80-85,000, but most of us in Canada, USA, Europe, and New Zealand, introducing them to the way we pray, mostly on the Sephardic tradition, but we have, some things are very different. The way we follow, you know, even our, especially our attitude when we enter synagogue is even more orthodox than a Sephardic tradition or orthodox tradition. So that's there. This is my maternal grandmother's Marathi Bible. I would leave my house and go there, and they were close by, and I would nighttime sleep there. And she wasn't that educated, but for her what was important is, as a children, we would know Bible, you know, the Torah, and she would read a few stories from the Torah, and that's the way we would sleep at night, and we were brought up. Then there were other books like the Bene Israel of India. This H.S. Kehinkar, he was the first historian, Bene Israel. We didn't have many historians among the Bene Israel. We had writers and we have compilers who just take from here, there and come up with a book. But historians, we didn't have many. Kehinkar was the first one who wrote their book, The History of the Bene Israel of India. And then there was one Shalim Samuel, an attorney in Mumbai. I wouldn't call him a historian. As I said, there were very few historians. You have Shalva Vail and Joan Roland and others from Israel who went to India. They stayed for years in India. They would do research, and those were the historians. Other what we have, the modern ones, they just compile, they pick up here, there, they make up. So we miss, but had it not for Kehinkar, the world wouldn't have known about us in terms of history. So I give them, as I said, there are compilers, there's one Bene Israel story, the origin of the Bene Israel. This is Shalim Samuel. He was an attorney, American Jew, who wrote about images, reality, Bene Israels of India. No. That's the sad part of the Bene Israel community, that we fail to create historians among our community. And till today, and we have now Rabbi Divekar in Israel, who is basically translating all the books, the remaining books, Hebrew, English, Hebrew and Marathi. He's doing, and there are others, the Heritage Foundation of Ben Israel in Israel. They are doing a lot. We are accepted in Israel as equal. We do our part. As I said, army, we are doing exceedingly well over there. The relations between Israel and India are great. And it's a matter of time. Another decade and we'll all just be Jews. No Ben Israel, no Cochin, no this, no Ashkenazi, and no Sephardic. God willing, we'll just be Jews.